Now we are in the second part, as I was saying, PyComs and ARMs hands-on. I think it's comms, okay, with Xiao, the PyComs session. As mentioned before, you need VirtualBox for run this, so I leave it here for your reference if you want to do this offline later. You can download here VirtualBox, you can go to this website when it works. Now it's not working, sorry about that. But when it works, you can go to the comms.vlc.es website and go to download the documentation and download the virtual machine, okay? And you will see exactly the same virtual machine I have provided you with the pen drives. So details of the virtual machine, the username and password is user and user, so very easy to remember. It has, if you open it, it has README files located on the desktop, so with all the information, how to compile and run applications, you will see that there are many applications there, not only the one I'm going to present, but it's going to be one of the basic. It's going to be matrix multiplication. And interesting to mention that I didn't say it in the presentation, but for comms we also provide an integrated development environment that is based on Eclipse, because it's quite a natural place for developers to work with. Okay, so we have integrated some of the capabilities of comms into Eclipse with a plugin. So there, if you open the Eclipse that it's in the image, you will have two workspaces, one for Java, if you want to work with Java applications, the Java examples that are provided, and one with Python. So if you start the machine, here's my screen. If you start the comms machine, okay, not the OMS one, the comms machine. As we said, if you cannot have it in your computer, maybe you can share or something. Okay, so you can arrange, or you can look at the screen. If you go to user and user, then you start, you see that you have the desktop. It has a very bad size resolution for my screen. But essentially, as I was mentioning, you have here some readmes, okay, for playing with the different applications that you have, and the Eclipse framework for programming. So the example we're going to see is the matrix multiplication example, very simple. As it was mentioned in the previous presentation, it's a matrix that is, instead of directly accessing the elements, it's divided in some blocks. So this is something that is interesting for very big matrices that don't fit into memory, so it's split into smaller pieces that fit into memory to work with them. The main program is very simple, it has a some initialization, and then it multiplies the blocks, okay? And when the application is executed, you will see that the multiply two blocks is going to be the task that is going to be generated, okay, and to be created for comms. So the data dependencies between all these different tasks are going to be handled. They are going to be scheduled on the available resources that we will submit in the local machine. So there will be just one resource, I believe. And the data will be transferred between the different resources. In this case, if we have just one resource, there won't be needed any transfers at all because they will be available.
Short question.
Say.
If you have multi-core on the computer, can that not be used to parallelize
file? It depends on the configuration file. I cannot recall if we have one or two resources, but we will see in the execution. Okay. So. I think if you go to the Eclipse, you can open it to check the code. I think you have to select the workspace, the standard workspace. The code should look like that. If you don't have it in the Eclipse, you can access directly in the directory of examples. Okay, that is. Let me check. I don't know why you have Eclipse open, if you open Eclipse, you can see that there are different examples that have been implemented. And if you open Matmul, you will see the sources. Okay. You can see the matrix multiplication, the main execution, the main program, and the implementation of the method, and the interface definition. Remember that we have to specify an interface for the operation we are going to run. Okay. So going back to the slides, this is what you should see in the virtual machine, okay? This main algorithm, and then this multiplication of the blocks. So I think the interface, there was a declaration of constraints, you see. This is an example, okay? It's not that in reality it does nothing parallel or something like that, but it's for you to have it as an example for in the case you needed to specify dependencies, okay? You see that the processor count is an integer, well, a natural number, and the memory physical size it's a float number, so you could specify 1.5 or 1 dot something. The interface file, as you can see, has the method and the parameters this method is receiving. This method is taking two blocks as inputs, okay, and another block as an input output, but because it's in the block that everything is accumulating this multiplication. Okay, so this is what these parameters are saying. These are files because these blocks are stored in files. We imagine that they are very big, right? And then we need to store them in files, and we just take them back to memory. We operate with them and we store them back into disk. Okay, it's just to exemplify this kind of operation with very big matrices. Okay. So now, if you want to start compiling to the application, you can go to the workspace, okay, and you can compile executing. Okay, you go to the workspace Matmul, you do the Java C. I think I already got this done in the virtual machine. You have to open a terminal. You open a terminal and you go to the workspace Matmul. There you have the command, okay, for doing the. I think I already have it there. I don't really import it. So you can copy the commands from the slides I have provided, so it will be faster. Jar file with the Matmul? Yes.
Mine is still importing.
Ah, okay. Importing. Are you there? Yes.
Right. Yeah, there we have slashes. We've got a different key band.
Yeah, I think you can change the configuration if you want in the virtual machine somewhere. I think you will be happier with the other machine because it has an English configuration. But somewhere you can change the configuration if you want. Or can you copy from the PDF file, maybe, the paths?
I was in a different place, I'd already got a bit explored. I'm honest, and now I'm trying to go backwards and find these slashes that exist.
Okay. Anyway, the objective is to build this jar file, okay, to make the program ready to be executed. You could do that from Eclipse with the Package Explorer, or into Matmul. If you make export there, you will do the creation of this jar file. Okay.
I think we should open it from the Wikipedia.
So after making this preparation of the jar file.
So this is a stupid question, but what is a jar file?
A jar file is a package of.
It's like zip file, zipped.
It's some sort of tar file with Java code.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, so there are no stupid questions. So ask whatever it comes to your mind, ask, okay? In this case, it's what we're going to deploy, let's say. Deploy means to copy in the machine where we're going to execute that, okay?
So that's the file we will actually execute. Like,
yeah, because of course, I was talking all the time of comms that it's a remote execution environment. So at some moment you prepare the code, but the code needs to be deployed. It needs to be copied into the different resources, okay? To make it ready for the execution. So this is what we call deploying. Okay, but in this case, since we are doing it in the same machine because we are working in the virtual machine, it's just a copy. Okay, you can copy into a different directory. So you can copy this jar file into your home directory. So now we have the jar file ready to be executed, let's say. This would be like our remote machine to run it. Yes, are we there, more or less, people?
Can you have
2 minutes? Yeah, sure, no problem. As you can see, now the application has finished, okay, in the screen. If you can, well, if you are not able to do it now, you can try to do it later, okay? But I wanted you to see the essence of the behavior, let's say. This is a very simple example with my local machine as a worker, let's say, as something that is providing work. But you can imagine, of course, different scenarios with clusters, with grids, clouds, whatever mixture of resources, okay, to this experiment. And you have in the clips, you have other examples, as you can see. We have simple examples, sparse Elu, Hammer examples, like for biology examples. So it's up to you to play with them, and if you have any questions or comments, we can catch up later. Okay. I think that for the comms part, that was mainly the thing. I got another exercise, but since we are a little bit running late, yeah, I think this was the test with Python. Just in case you prefer the Python case, okay? Because we have seen the Java case. If you want to work with the Python case, you have to start the Eclipse IDE, with the other workspace, okay? The Python workspace, and then you will have there the code available, so you can inspect the code there and all this stuff. And you can play again with the. So depending on if you want to test more Python or Java, you can do that.
Eclipse or
Commander. And the last thing I wanted to show you about comms. We are a little bit late, but anyway, I will go on so you can see it, and later maybe you can test it, okay? It's a little long to be done, but there is an exercise also included about using this IDE, this graphical interface, so programming something with Eclipse and the comms extensions. So there is a program already implemented there to convert numbers to words. So a very silly example, let's say, but just for you to learn the infrastructure. So you put a chain of numbers and this is converted to text. And you have the instructions here in the slides about how to go step by step in order to create this. Because as I was mentioning in the explanation, we have something that is called orchestration elements and core elements. So recall that thing, that two things, that the orchestration elements are the main program, let's say, or the main algorithm that is going to build this workflow. And the core elements are the specific tasks that are going to be executed. So when you are going to create this, you can do it following these steps. So as you can see, it's pretty much integrated in Eclipse by these screens. In this case, you have to open the Eclipse with the Eclipse user space. You will see that the three workspaces are already defined in the in the Eclipse environment, so if you close the Eclipse.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to feel better. I can actually run it now.
Sorry?
I'm running it now.
You're running it?
Yeah.
Did you see the monitor?
Yeah.
I'm waiting for the browser to kick in again.
Ah.
It's,
I have no idea how to leave this.
It's starting to disappear.
This is the task, right?
So if you see when you open Eclipse, you have three different workspaces, okay? If you want to work with the Java examples, you select this first workspace. If you want to work with Python, there is also a matrix multiplication in Python. If you want to investigate that, you can open with that workspace and check the code, and you have the instructions in the slides. And the third workspace is dedicated to the ID, that is the last exercise that is in the slides. That is in order to use all the parts of this ID. The funny thing, or the interesting thing about the ID, is that you don't even have to prepare this structure of files, let's say. You know that we say that we have a main file, we have another file with the methods or the functions, okay? And we have an extra file with the interface.
Mm.
This Eclipse environment helps you to generate all this. So you start with wizards or some easy options from the menus, and these pieces of these skeletons of code are generated for you, so you have an easier starting point. Okay.
This is because we have a comms extension, or
yes, yeah. Because it's a plugin of Eclipse.
Yeah.
And it can be downloaded also from the website. You have it in the virtual machine, but if you are interested in having it in your environment, you can download it. So later on, if you want, you can test it, and you will see that it's pretty simple. You have to create a new project, create an application, okay, with comms. Then you go and create an orchestration class, that is what is going to have the different orchestration elements, okay? You will put the name, that it will be this number conversor application. Then at the top, we have created this container of core elements, let's say, but then later we have to create the specific core elements, so this main method, that it's indicated here by the arrow. So you create a new orchestration element, you specify that it's the main program, okay, that receives some arguments, some parameters, okay. Then after creating the core element, the orchestration element, sorry, the main part, we have to create the core element, that is the method that is going to be executed remotely, this task, okay. So in this case, we have two options available. We can create a core element from something that is already existing, so it's something that you have already code, but you want it to become a core element. So you will select this option, and you select a jar file that has been already created, so you have the code there, and the system will be able to take the code there and convert it to a core element, okay? But also the other option is that you can add this core element from scratch, so you want to add something that will be a core element, and you want to program it yourself later, okay? So in this case, you select this other option, create a core element from scratch, and you add the parameters, and the system will generate both a basic template for you to program and the interface file related to that component, okay? So you don't have to specify, you have already specified all this information of the metadata that you need to pass to the function, and then it will be available already.
I can add other functions later.
You can add your functions later.
If I want to add core elements, because usually you program, you don't know everything in that.
This is just an example for one, because it is very simple, right? Mm. But in theory, here, you could add as many core elements as you want.
No, I'm thinking like if I finish this wizard, and then I can just add other stuff afterwards, right?
If you finish this and you do, you can add later, your program is dynamic, I mean. You can continue programming, okay, and then when you're done, you maybe want to modify something, or you want to add more functions, you can add them, and the system will help you to have this kind of templates for doing it more easily, okay? So, well, in fact here, if you continue the exercise later, you will see that we need to put the code, okay, the main program, and you will have it here in this reference. So when you do the exercise, you go to this web page and you will see that there are pieces of code, so you can copy and paste and you don't have to program everything, right? So it was ready for doing it fast, but in the end it didn't work out very well. Sorry about that. Murphy's law, you know. Finally, yes, this is commenting about adding dependencies. So for instance, if you see that one of the pieces of the code needs a different jar file because there is code that you are going to be used there, you can add that as a dependency so that the system will be in charge of putting all the code together and packaging together for later doing the deployment, okay? In fact, this is one of the interesting things of this tool, right? That it helps you not only to program or to put all these things more easily or more in a visual manner, okay? But also it helps you to deploy the application. What we have done of copying locally, imagine that you have to do this remotely to different machines, right? This would be like copying here and there, it's a difficult thing. This tool has capabilities for doing copies into different machines also. So we have here a deployment that is a local, let's say, for the local machine, but some other deployments could be configured in order to make this copy to a different environment. In fact, one of the projects, we got a component that was creating the virtual image for the cloud. It was for the cloud, okay? So it was, you got the code ready, and there was a component that you push the code there, and that component created a virtual image to be deployed in the cloud, right? So it was completely transparent for the user. Because this is something of the burden that users that are using the cloud need to do, you know, that it's preparing the images in order to be deployed and used later for the cloud. So this is some sort of help into that direction, okay? This is the other example. So the first one was the deployment on the on locally, let's say, and the other was in a grid, let's say, or in a set of resources that you can configure in the different configuration files, okay, and you could do it. So after that, if you want, as I said before, there is more free practice. You have there plenty of examples. You can play with them. If you want to play with the Java example, remember to take this workspace with the Python this other workspace. You can even try to use your own code if you're there. So I encourage you to do that. And also it's possible if you want to try to install the tools in your environment, okay, if you want to download and try, but it's something we can try. So now we're switching to the second part of the tutorial, okay? Well, do you have any questions or comments about that?
So do we try to do this in parallel or do we wait until we complete?
No, I think we should now stop because the time is running low now, okay. I'm sure, and we probably, I prefer the feeling, right, and how things have to be done,
okay,
because
sure.
I didn't expect so many problems with the virtual machines. Okay. I thought that things were going to be more smooth. So I hope you have get the feeling of what I expected you to check or to test.
Mm-hmm.
I have seen that some of you have done a first experiment or a first run,
mm-hmm.
which is nice.
Okay.
So, and the other experiments, if you have some time and you want to try,
mm-hmm.
up to you. I will be around, we can discuss, we can chat. We are available by email, so we will be happy to hear from you.
What does abbreviation stand for, COMS?
Sorry?
What does the COMS stand for?
Ah, it's the COMS is component. It comes because this is from a great architectural design, so it comes from a different thing. But the important part is the superscalar. The COMS is COMS superscalar. Superscalar makes reference to how superscalar processors work. I don't know if you have background in computer science, so in computers, if you have background in computer science, superscalar processors, what they do, in fact, to achieve parallelism at the instruction level, it's the same we're doing here at this level. They analyze inputs and outputs of every instruction, they build this workflow dependence graph, and they do this parallelism because there are no data dependencies. So this is where the idea comes from in reality, from the design of microprocessors or superscalar processors, I would say. So if you Google it, for instance, or you see Wikipedia, you will see a lot of more information about superscalar processors, okay? And this probably will show something about this idea. So anything else from the COMS part? Okay, so we move on to the next virtual machine. So if you want, you can close the COMS one and play later with it. And then you should start the OMS one, okay? The OpenMP superscalar one.
I don't know. I don't know what the application for itself.
So essentially, this one I think has auto login, so even if the user and password is the same user, it logs in automatically. You also have the same. You have a. In case you don't have it, you will have it, but in case you lost it or whatever, you can download it from there. The virtual machine has this user and password. It has also written files in the desktop, so for you to play. Apps, the applications are located in this directory, in desktop applications. You also have the sources and different builds. One of the things that, because the virtual image was quite big, so we had to reduce it a little bit in order to be capable of distributing. So there is not installed in this machine MPI, MKL, that is a numerical library, and the CUDA extensions. So if you are going to play with these examples, they are not probably going to work. So in case you are interested in these technologies, I encourage you to download the tools from the website, okay, and to test it in your environment.
What is CUDA exactly?
CUDA is the API that it's that you can use to program GPUs.
Okay.
You know, usually there are the two APIs that are CUDA and OpenCL. Mm-hmm. So usually, depending on the user, uses one and another, or depending on the system you are programming. So, and because this is what I mentioned before in the presentation, that we are able to use these resources. You know that right now some computers have this hybrid machine where you have regular CPUs and GPUs. So we are able not only to execute in the CPUs, but also make use of the GPUs at the same time for the application, right? So extracting more power from that particular node.
That means as long as you've got CUDA, you won't have to change anything on your code?
Sorry, again?
In case that you've got CUDA and want to work on GPUs, do you have to change anything on your code?
For CUDA you have to program in a particular way, because you have to program a kernel in order to work with CUDA. But usually when you work with CUDA, you will program this kernel and then your main program will deal with all the things you have to do in the GPU. For instance, if you have a main program, it will progress, and then when you want to execute something in the GPU, you'll have to send data there, send the computation there, and then when it finishes, have a synchronization and get the data back, you know, all this. So all these things, when you're using OMS, are not needed because are transparent. The runtime system handles that for you. Okay, so in your main code, you won't have this transfer of data or to say, let's execute this in GPUs. The runtime will do that for you and it will be transparent. You don't seem convinced.
No. Okay, that means I've got OMS and I've got CUDA, both in parallel.
But I think you're mixing concepts. CUDA is an API, let's say, what you use for programming GPUs.
Oh, okay.
So you can program from OMS, or you can execute from OMS to both, to the regular CPU and to the GPU, right? This is the concept.
Okay.
Yes. The CUDA thing, just forget.
Okay, good.
Let's say it's the API for programming, okay? Also, you have the applications in different, in the folder. In the image, you will see that the applications are structured in different folders related on the different topics. As I said, some of the topics may not work, but if you want, you know, you have the time or the interest to work in some of the particular code, you can do it. If you go to this website, pmbsc.es, and you go to OMS examples and exercises, you will see that they will have the same. In fact, I don't have even internet connection, so I cannot show you. But maybe later, if the system is up, we can test it. So essentially, if you look at the directories in the virtual machine, you see that there are 1, 2, 3, 4 directories, okay, that is what I'm describing here in the slides. The first one is a stream benchmark that is implemented with OpenMP, well, with OMS and the SIL programming language. You can see examples of using barriers or for how dependencies are calculated. The one I wanted to do in a step-by-step manner is the matrix multiplication, because we have already seen it in the other examples, so you are more familiar with that. That it's written in C, but you have also dot product and multisort examples. And as mentioned before, you have examples for working with GPUs. So there is a matrix multiplication that is implemented with OMS using C, and in this case using CUDA, okay? And in another, in a second case, it's OMS with C and OpenCL in order to access the GPU device. Yes, please.
The Kolesky wouldn't compile without MKL library?
No, it won't.
Okay, so
it needs it, yeah.
Okay.
Either you download it and install it, or you can do it in your system.
Yeah.
But I think the web is not working.
Okay.
Keep trying if you want, but
yeah, okay.
Because at some moment it has to be up. Come on. And so the last example is what I mentioned before, like hybrid applications, right? These are applications that combine both MPI, like for coordinating the work between the different nodes, and inside the node, the parallelism is exploited with OMS. Okay, and you have two examples that are called, well, the matrix multiply that we have seen, and one called the QGFR. So if you are happy to check these examples at any moment, feel free to do that. So again, this is the code of the matrix multiplication. If you check in the code, in the subdirectory, if you go to the introduction directory and you go to the matmul, if you edit the code, okay, you will see that the code is already implemented and ready to be executed in OMS, okay? It has the pragma already implemented there. So you can see that the code it has a main program and it has a function, okay? You feel free to explore it. This is an initialization function, and somewhere we have the main. We have the main code, okay, that is doing this initialization, this computation, and the computation is doing, in fact, the multiplication. But the important function that we are executing is the matrix multiplication, okay, by blocks that you have here in the code. So here you can see that the header has some particularity. Well, in fact, maybe you can see that better in the slide. Do you see something strange in this declaration, in this pragma? Well, I went very fast to this part in that, but in fact, the curious thing here in this example is that if you see the matrix declarations that I mentioned in the previous hour, in the theory, let's say, all were behind, you know, you specified the size of the parameter, okay? But this was for declarations that were already, in the declaration was already this size, so. And this is a little bit a tricky thing, that when we don't know the size of a parameter, you can declare it explicitly in the code, so for the OMS runtime to take into account the whole block for dependencies, okay? So even if you don't know the size, we specify it here, and we do it in front of the parameter, okay? It's some sort of a special syntax, but the objective is the same, okay? The objective is to specify the size of this block, that it's NB times NB, so this is the size of the total block, okay? So it's just a particularity, but just because maybe you see the slides of the theoretical part and you see it here and say, why is that in the front, you know? It's because of that, because it's a special case, right? Because it's a case where we don't know the size in the code.
Why is C in out?
Sorry?
Why is the matrix C in out?
Do you want to read it?
Yeah. Yeah, because the multiplication is A multiplied by B equals to C,
yeah.
But C is accumulated there.
Okay.
I mean, you don't start from zero.
Yeah, okay.
So it's every two cells are accumulated in that. So it's why it's an input-output. You read from the block and you write in the block, okay?
Right.
But the other two are inputs because you only read them.
Yeah. Sure.
Okay. So I think we are ready to make the compilation. If you check the directory, you will see that there is a makefile ready and some scripts to run the examples. Something interesting to mention is that when you compile it, you will have three versions of the executable program. So you have one that is performance, so let's say it's focused for achieving the maximum performance, and it has no instrumentation at all, because instrumentation, you know that it comes with a cost, let's say. You have it has a little bit of an overhead. So we have this performance version, we have an instrumented version that it's ready to work with parallel, okay, that is something that we are going to see now. And there is also a debug version, so with -g flag in order to, if you want to debug the code. But in this case, since everything is prepared, you don't need to do that, okay? But just if you play with other examples, you will see that you have these three different versions, okay, of the compilations. So right now, the actions you can do for this code, just edit it as we have been doing, inspect it. You can see that that we have a single directive, okay, OMS directive, going to execute that function in parallel. So you can now compile if you haven't done it. I think again the keyboard. Oh no, in this case the keyboard is in English, right? So maybe you are more happy with that. But if not, in the top here in this virtual machine, you can change it easily if you go to the top and then you select here the character map you have in your keyboard. Okay. So I already have it compiled, but if you do make here, okay. I'm sorry. Yeah. If you compile it here, you will have again these three executables to be submitted. Okay. Then we have a very simple script that is called run once.sh, so a shell script for running the application. So one thing you can do is to edit this and make a few tests. Okay. In this case, I already changed this. For the, but in theory you can put here the performance one, okay, because we don't want to trace in the beginning, and then you can change the second parameter. I don't know if you can read it, but if you edit the file, you will see that here it says NX args hyphen hyphen SMP hyphen workers equals to something. This is going to specify how many workers are we going to have for this region of parallelism, okay? So
it's the number of cores.
Ideally, it should be the number of cores, of course, because if you put it more, it will probably overload the system and it won't pay off. It will make the system perform worse. Mm-hmm. But here, since we are doing a silly test, or a toy test, let's say, you can play with this variable environment, okay? And you can define here maybe two. I think the virtual machine is configured for two. But you can do this, I don't know, a couple of executions to see that this is. And here you see the information, okay, this execution is just a very brief summary, but this execution has been run with two threads, as we have specified, the time it takes, and the mflops, it's the floating point operation, so the performance of the algorithm, how it has performed, let's say, the summary of that information, right? So it's for you to play a little bit. If you want to change this to a different number,
you can just write
one more. We can put 6, for instance.
Yeah, I think like that.
And make another execution, okay? In fact, it gives you a warning, as she was saying, that this is bigger than the available CPU, so maybe you are going to have a problem, right? This is not very recommended, but you could do it, okay? And now, if I'm not mistaken, yes, so after these initial tests, what we can do is to generate a trace file, okay, to make analysis with parallel of this execution. So in theory, you would do that with adding a hyphen instrument flag to the compilation, but you don't have to do that because it's ready in the make file. So we have generated this file, matmul-i, from instrumentation. So the only things we need to do is to change in this script the program, okay?
With an I.
I don't know if you are guys testing it or you are bored, yes. Or but at least if you can follow, I'm happy with that. Are you good? Good, Alan. You don't seem to.
I'm testing your dot products and seeing the
difference. Ah, okay. You are on your own then. You are more advanced, okay. So, in this case, let's say, for instance, we're going to make a test with two workers. That is the most natural way to go with this virtual machine configuration. And we have a couple of environment variables that we need to specify. The first one, you don't need to, because we have this this over flag in order to specify the number of threads, but you could also specify it with an environment variable, okay, to set the number of threads that OMS is going to use. In this case, 2 or 4, whatever you feel it's interesting to explore. But also, the thing you have to do is that you export the instrumentation package to be extracted. This is the tool I was mentioning before that helps you into instrumenting this code. Okay. I don't know if I already had it here to find. I will tell you now.
Okay.
It's just before, because in the instrumentation, I just did this, okay? I changed the configuration file in order to put that I want to execute this binary,
yeah.
Not the other one, okay? You can specify there also the number of threads you want to use, 2, 4, 6, whatever you want to see in the trace. And then we configure the tool that is going to do to create the trace file, okay, that is extract that I mentioned in the previous presentation. So you have to put this first environment variable. You don't need to specify because we have this shell script that already does this configuration. But these two, you have to put it in your environment, okay? Just exactly these lines. So to export the instrumentation of nanos to be extracted, and to export the configuration file of extracted of this XML that has some configuration for doing the trace. Okay.
So we're gonna do this now.
Yes. If you are there, you can do it. If not, I will show you.
Yeah.
You are there. Have you done the environment variables?
No, we just ran the program so far, but we can do the exports.
Yeah.
I was just unsure if some of this was in the file or something.
Well,
yeah.
if you edit the shell script, then you can have these changes in the configuration. Okay, I can show you.
First,
you
have to do a thing.
The wrong ones.
Yeah.
The script is the wrong one, remember that. Are you good there? Okay.
What
would
the other stuff?
The export.
Sorry. I'm going back there. Ah, you have it there. Perfect.
By the way, if you're using more threads than CPUs, if you're using more threads than CPUs, why do you still have a higher flops?
Because in this case, the computation is not so big, let's say, it's not so overloaded, let's say. It's not an example that it's very demanding, but typically it's not a good thing to be done in real applications, let's say. As I was saying, this is a toy example, so it's a didactical thing.
Also, you could just copy all of it and then
So how are we doing there? Finding the next variables. You can copy it from the screen if you want, if it's more easy. I don't know. Up to you. And this is a small mistake, you don't have to submit the application directly. You can do that, but of course we have this other script, okay, this run once script. We're going to use that one, okay, for doing the execution. That in fact is doing something similar to that.
No, you can use this one. Run the trace where I generated.
You have the my trace, so try that one. Yeah.
When you run it, you will see that there is a lot of more information going on the screen because this is provided by Xtry, okay, the tracing tool that is giving some output in order to see that if the tracing is going correctly or not. This is not very important right now because we are not having a look at Xtry. But the important thing is that we have generated a trace file, okay, in the end. So the only thing we need to do at the end is to run parallel with that trace file.
Yeah.
So it's WX parallel with the trace, and you can do it in the background, so you can, or you can do it in the foreground as you want. So parallel.
Yeah.
Okay.
So what we do there?
This is what parallel looks like.
I think we already have
the first screen. So are we there, guys?
Yes.
Cool. You guys. So now, as I said, here you have parallel. So as I mentioned in the previous presentation, if you go to the help and tutorials, you have plenty of information here to learn more about parallel. Okay, if you are more, you want to know more about how to do analysis and things like that, you can just check this information and make some.
How to plug it onto our backend.
Sorry.
How to plug it into our backend.
Ah, you read something. So now we're going to see typical, let's say, configuration files, because the way we work with parallel is that we have this trace file, but we have configuration files that filter this information or get this information, right? As I was saying, in timelines or in tables. So the typical configuration files that we use, there is a lot of configuration files available for parallel, okay? But we are going to focus in the ones that deal with OMS applications, okay? They are in this folder here. If you go to the, well, the sources, OMS, nanos, doc, parallel, config, you will find all of them there, okay? And you will have, in that folder, you will see that there are several configuration files that are typical to do this analysis, okay? So we are going to open the first configuration file that is under all these paths, in tasks, 2DP tasks, okay? I will try to do it with you in the in a parallel window. I have it here, the folder, but I will. So if you do load configuration file from parallel and you navigate through all that through the builds, OMS, no, builds, sources, in sources you have to go. Or in general, I think it's in both, but it's better if you take the one in sources. Well, I think they are copied, so they are more or less the same. So if we go to make it correct, to sources, OMS, sources, OMS, nanox, doc, parallel, a little bit hidden, you can see.
So which one did you choose?
2D tasks, maybe?
Yeah.
Parallel configs, OMS, and then after that you have to go to the tasks folder because there are many configuration files, right? So the whole path is this one. From your home directory, sources, OMS, nanos, doc, parallel config files. Sorry about that, but this is how it's configured. And we opened the 2DP tasks. Did you find it?
Yeah.
Good. You too? Okay. So if we open that, we will see that that 2D two-dimensional representation of that table, okay? If you remember in the previous presentation, this was like a colored feeling, to get the feeling of the application, okay, to see what are the problems. In this case, it's very simple, so this color view doesn't give you maybe a lot of information. But if you remove the zoom, you have the statistics more detailed, okay? So you can see that this application has been run, in my case, I don't know in yours, but in my case it has been run with two threads, okay? The code has been in the main process 85% of the time, and 86%. Don't be scared about the total because it's not in a real percentage, it's an addition of all of them. So if you have two threads, the total would be like 200. If you have four, 400, okay, it's not a real percentage. Maybe this should be modified, but don't get puzzled by that. Ah, no, sorry, this was the matmul operation at 95% of the time, and then the main program has been a 9% of the time, okay? Barely at 10% of the time. So you have statistics about how this execution has worked.
Short question, what was the end thing?
Sorry?
The end thing, the first column, what's that?
The end, I think it's I can't remember right now.
It might be idle time.
Sorry?
It might be idle time once the process is finished before everything is actually complete.
Yeah, maybe. Let's see the trace if we can identify what is exactly. Because I don't remember the source code, but maybe if you look at the source code, there is an end function or something like that. Or I don't know. Well, after that, after this 2D, you can open directly either from this configuration, you can open what we call the control window, okay? Or you could achieve the same by going to the task directory. So you go back and go to the task directory. Well, not in this same directory, task name and location. So if you do that with the control window, just click here, to open the control window, okay? And a new window appears. And this window has information about the execution. So what happened?
This is not the same.
No? What did you do?
I know it's something.
How many
threads? Coming down from the sky.
Because you open a different view, I think.
Okay.
Because you clicked the standard one.
Oh,
no, you have to open the in the file.
Okay.
In the configuration. You have it. Did you have the 2D that I was showing?
Yes.
Okay, so from the open the 2D, the 2D key task, yes. And from there, it's here.
Ah.
Yeah, this C. Okay, this is what we call the control window, right? Yeah, the control window. It can be achieved in another using another configuration file. So if you explore, if you pass the mouse around the paragraph trace, you will see that. I don't know if you have run with two threads or more threads, but if you go, you will see that. In which, this is a timeline, so this is how the execution has progressed. You can see that the first thread has done some work at the beginning, right? If you go, this is the main program, so probably this is the all the initialization steps, you know. Are you checking also the trace file?
Yes, so we're doing it one.
So if you go, if you zoom in maybe, or...
maximum?
Well, maybe not maximum. Because we will compare another... Hopefully we will compare another trace file.
Okay.
So if you pass the mouse on the top, you see information, okay, about the... So in the beginning, you see that the first thread has been running one of the initialization, let's say, okay? So Anna, you are on your own, right? You're doing your...
It will be here, I haven't really saw it.
Anyway, I will continue with the explanation.
It showed something totally different than the previous one, because this basically shows that, for example, the first thread did not run the end function, whatever it was, just the last bit, last few percentages, whereas the other one said it's just like 3% or something like that.
For me, the end function is here.
But it's really small, I think it's...
Yeah. It was the case, right, in the 2D, or not?
Okay, you're right, yeah. It's 3%, yeah, we did, right.
So the interesting thing to see here is that we have an initialization a step, let's say, a little bit big. You see that the first thread, the second thread is it's not doing anything, so it's in this end function or whatever. And the first one is in the main program that it's probably creating the matrices, because you know that the program starts creating the input. So all this time has been creating the things, until it finally starts the computation, you see in the tool. You could even zoom, you know, in the select regions if you want to go into more detail about any part, okay? You can see that you have number indications at the bottom for the time scale, okay? Yeah, we can see here. So this is this amount of microseconds. And if you want to go back to the zoom, you just undo the zoom, okay? And it goes to the previous one, or if you do the fit time scale, it shows you the whole application again. Okay. So this is essentially the first part. So you can see that there is the information of the execution, and we are going to see now the state of the different threads for the ohms runtime, okay? That this is something that could be interesting also when you are executing an application. This is in the same folder, you go back, if you open a configuration file, well, you can close that window if you want. In fact, the window is still there, so if you want to recover it, you can double click again, okay? Once it's open. And now we go to a different configuration file. So we go, instead of the tasks folder, we go back and we go to the runtime. So we are going to analyze something about the runtime. And we load this thread state configuration file. That is here, okay?
Yes.
You have it?
Yeah.
Yes, Philip?
Which one? Threads?
Thread state.
State, yeah, got it.
What's the difference between this one and the last one?
That's why I'm going to explain.
Different colors. Means running. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, if you see now, if you go up, if we do the same, we go up in the trace file and we go in the top, we see that we have the threads or the state of the threads that ohms has. This is what this trace showing. So in this case, we don't know the information of the function that it's executed. We know the state of the thread. So at the beginning, this thread was running things, okay? And if you see, the second thread was idle, it wasn't doing anything, okay? This is the information we have here. And then later on, we have time for creation of tasks, that in the beginning, you know, that this generation of the workflow, mm-hmm. This is the time we can see here, mm-hmm. Okay, in this part of the trace. And we can see that later the creation continues. So the runtime starts scheduling tasks, even when the creation has not finished. Okay. It's something interesting to be seen.
So this can be good if I have like loads of functions and I don't want to see each function when it has executed each function, but only like when it's running and when it's doing mm-hmm. stuff. Is that
you could, yeah. In fact, the interesting thing is to open two traces at the same time, right? So for instance, you could do that. Open the control window we got before, and if I'm able to put it in the screen, the typical thing to do here. It's to compare.
So that was my question. So the first trace, you have this end thing which corresponds to running in the first part of the second figure.
No, it's the pink.
No, it's
the pink is the main. Yeah.
Yeah. If we put them together and we can compare. More or less, you see, now that they are together.
So for the second thread, the red part in the first figure is end, I think?
In the first figure?
Yes.
This part is idle, means that nothing is executed, okay? This thread is waiting for work to come. So we see that, of course, this is an example for use, okay? But in this application, for instance, we have a very big initialization time, so this is lowering the performance of the execution, right? Somehow. And you see the information is different in the two parts because, and it's interesting to see that when the threads are running, work, we are in the matrix multiplication, right? If you see a comparison, we are in this phase of the, and when the threads are creating, we are in the main program. Because the main program is executed, okay, it continues and generates more tasks to the workflow.
Sorry,
okay.
What's the distinction between running and runtime?
Running and runtime.
Yeah.
Running is the state. The runtime is the environment that allows you, that makes this analysis.
But if you zoom into one of like not that pink one, but that one to the right of this one that you're almost close to, go to the right.
Which one, sorry?
zoom into one of the pink ones. Like
one of
the first figure? No, the first figure.
First figure?
Yeah, I'm not sure that one, maybe.
In this one?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe. You see green stuff there? The green at the bottom. The small green line?
Yeah.
Yeah, that says runtime.
Runtime, yeah. I think this is maybe more specific, right? From something that the runtime is doing.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe more analysis of dependencies or something
mm-hmm.
like that.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, if you see here, now that we zoom, we see a lot of more states. So we see scheduling, we see creation. In fact, it seemed to be only creation, but we can see a lot of more states.
Mm.
And in fact, something interesting that for you to know is If you are zooming one of the windows and you want the second window to match the first one, because of course you want to visually compare, the only thing you have to do is to copy here. So in the window you have the zoom that is interesting for you, you copy, and then you go to the window and you paste the fault, okay, that it's all the configuration. So it will go to the same, you see, it will go to the same exact position in the timeline of the thing. Okay. It matches what we see in the first thread. So, oh, sorry. And now the last one that's maybe interesting for you to see, it's the creation of the graph, what I was mentioning. So if we go to the configuration file and we open this in the graph and scheduling folder, we'll open the NB task in graph. This is the creation and consumption of tasks in the runtime. Okay, this is again information of the runtime.
Which file, sorry?
Yeah, let me just graph configuration. We go to the graph and scheduling subfolder, okay, and then we go to the NB tasks in graph.
Okay.
This one. So you see a strange line here that maybe makes more sense when we map it with this. So this is not matching. If you see this number is the, let me check if it's providing information. It doesn't show now. Well, in this line what represents is the creation of tasks. Okay? I think this is in theory when you go with the mouse on the top, you should see the values. Okay, but I don't know why, so I'm showing it now. Anyway, what you can see here is that what I was mentioning before, that the runtime is not generating all the tasks at the beginning and then later it's consuming them. Okay, at the same time the runtime is generating new tasks, so this managed multiplication main program is generating tasks, the tasks are consumed. So if you see, there is a creation of tasks, so the number of tasks in the runtime increase, but then we execute them, so they decrease. But then there is another step of creation tasks. So this is because the runtime of OMS has some sort of boundaries to start or generating tasks or not, right? So in order to avoid a very big generation of tasks at the beginning that don't let you progress with the computation, or the opposite. So probably there is some sort of threshold here around, I don't know, 2,500 tasks or something like that. When there are these enough tasks, the runtime can start consuming tasks. But then when it reaches some sort of boundary, probably around 1,000 tasks or something like that, the creation process starts again. Okay, and then we see this number of tasks increasing again. So this is how it behaves until the execution finishes completely. And if you see these peaks correspond to the top trace, to the creation stages, okay? If you see, every one of these peaks in this counter corresponds to the creation. So we are seeing what are the moments of... In fact, this last one is very, very small, because we can see that there were very few tasks remaining there, okay? So that's all from my side. If you want, we can test with a different number of threads and see what happens. In fact, it has behaved quite differently from the test I did before this course, because in my test it had like a big generation and then two consumptions. So maybe you can try with different threads and see what happens. Okay. Any questions so far?
The threads that you can allocate when you're working in a virtual machine is would be lesser than the actual cores that you have available in the computer, right?
The thread state?
Yeah,
I don't understand why. I'm sorry, I don't understand the question.
Because when I try to allocate more number of threads, it says that the available CPU doesn't have that many number of threads.
They will find more. So if you put here, for instance, 6 threads and run the test again, you'll probably see more of these collisions between the different threads.
Okay.
We can try it now.
I think the question was that she has like 8-core computer, but when you have this virtual machine, you can only
have
like 2 threads.
Yeah, the problem is the virtual machine, it has only 2.
Yeah.
But probably if you...
We can use 8 threads, but it's going to complain a little bit.
If you dig into the options of the virtual machine, maybe you are able to change that configuration,
okay.
And you are able to put more cores to the machine.
Mm-hmm.
But you can even do that test without having the cores and see what happens.
Mm-hmm.
Any more questions?
Why doesn't it complete all the tasks before I'm creating new ones? Because I would assume that it takes some time, a few microseconds, whatever, in order to change what it's doing back to creating new tasks.
You mean why it doesn't finish all the tasks before creating new? Because then you are stopping the execution.
Okay, almost all tasks. Because almost,
yeah,
I would say
almost for the runtime is that number. So let's say that at this level, the runtime starts to think, hey, I'm going to you need more work to progress, so I need to start the generation again. So this is, I don't know very much of the internals of OMS, to tell you the truth, but I know that they have this let's say boundaries to in order to put this throttle of creation, okay, of tasks. So in the end, the objective is not to reach zero here, because if you reach zero, you don't have work to progress, so everything is stopped and you are losing performance. Okay.
And maybe another question, which may be due to a misunderstanding, but if I want to use different programming languages, how can I transfer the whole aspect to using C++, MATLAB, whatever? I would assume MATLAB is quite difficult.
You mean if you want to trace it, or if you want to program?
If I want to use all the programs for different programming languages, instead of using Java or Python.
As I mentioned, it has the different languages have different bindings, okay?
Mm-hmm.
In the case of COMS, the other example we were seeing in the beginning, the natural language was Java, but we also made bindings for C, C++, or Python. So when you have programs running with these programming languages, you can run them. In the end, the runtime is going to run, let's say, in Java, the part of the control, but your code is going to be in C or C++ or what you have. In the case of OMS, since the goal is a little bit different, as I was mentioning, the bindings that they have selected to implement are C, C++, and Fortran, if I'm not mistaken. So in this case, if you want to work with Fortran for applications, you would be able to do that. But in the case of the OMS runtime, the Nanos++ that I was presenting before, the implementation is done in C. So this is the difference between these two runtimes, the implementation, one is done in Java and the other is done in C. But in reality, you can play with different programming languages. And in fact, if you have a different programming language, you could build a binding for that. For instance, there is a lot of people working with R, you know, this statistical programming package. And we are considering also to put a binding for COMS for R, you know, because so the users will be able to just define their applications in R, and then later it will be executed like it's done right now.
And that means in case that people actually want to work with different languages like R or whatever, they're really just programming new bindings, or it's just like they are using alternatives to OMS and COMS?
No, you need to have a binding for that language, because we need to support the languages that you program, you know, because we put this in the case of the pragmas or in the case of interfaces, so every language has some particularities.
But I mean, there should be some alternatives to OMS and COMS which work similarly.
Are you meaning, what are our competitors?
Basically, yeah.
Ah, yeah.
And they support other languages.
There are plenty, so.
They support other languages?
In fact, for the COMS case, that is the one I work more on, typically, the related work, I categorize it in different categories, because programming with workflows in distributed infrastructures has different approaches. There are some work that people define a new API, so something that for instance, as we said, in Amazon or things like that. If you want to work with Amazon, you have to use this API. So you are pushing all this to the end user responsibility. If you want to use it, you move the work there, you execute, and you handle everything. But of course, this is more difficult to the user. There are others that follow an approach that it's more graphical. Let's say I have a drawing interface, and I draw there the nodes and the connections, okay? And this is very nice for end users because it's very intuitive, or I mean, it's good. But of course, it has a problem of scalability. You saw that the graph we generated before, how do you draw that? It's like a thousand of boxes, you know, it's more difficult.
Takes some time.
Yeah, so, I mean, for some examples it's good, but maybe for others it's not so good. And other programming languages, I don't know, Swift or any other, I think in the papers I can give you some references if you're interested, but the thing is that they even create a new language for people to program this kind of workflows. So for us, this is some kind of drawback, let's say, because people have to learn a new programming language, that it's not the natural way they program. So our philosophy is that the more close you get to the how the user is working, the easier he will be using it and taking the advantage of the technology. But if you are interested, I can give you more references or interesting papers to read. Okay. So more questions or comments? I think we are right on time. No? So just as I mentioned, you have the material and the slides. Let me know if you don't. So if you want to practice more in your spare time or maybe next week during summer, just do it. I mean, and contact us. You have the mailing list. You have the references for downloading the code and trying to install it in your system. So we'll be more than happy to hear from you. And I hope you liked all these tutorials. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.